Well, welcome everybody. We're just waiting for the last few people to join us before we kick off. Okay, I think we'll make a start. Right, well, good evening, everybody. Good evening, and a very warm welcome to the online Naturetrek Roadshow. This is the first winter since the late 1980s that we haven't actually been out on the road, speaking in venues across the country, delivering our popular presentation evenings. However, we're delighted to be doing it on a new online format, so you can all join us from the warmth and comfort of your own home. I hope you've got a cup of tea or a glass of wine and that you're sitting comfortably. So our plan for each evening is to give you the very best armchair travel that we can by taking you to some of the world's most superb wildlife destinations, tonight focusing on South America. Please bear with us. This is new for us too. We're used to really feeding off the spark of a live audience in person. So this is somewhat different for all of us, but we're really excited to be giving this a go. I'm Sarah Frost. I'm Naturetrek's marketing manager and the leader of our cruises, and I'll be your host this evening. It's a dark, cold night here in Alton in Hampshire, where I'm speaking to you from, but it really is just such a pleasure to be doing something positive for you all on a winter's night like this, especially with yesterday's news of a renewed lockdown. To be able to bring you these presentations and hopefully brighten your evenings is really what we want to do and what this is all about. And indeed, we've been overwhelmed by the number of you who've wanted to join us. We've had over 330 people sign up for this evening, many of whom will be watching with other members of their households, of course. So we could guesstimate perhaps we've actually got more like 400 or 500 people watching us tonight. And if you're new to Naturetrek and the talks this evening tempt you to request a brochure, which I'm sure they will, normally, of course, we'll be handing these out in our actual presentation evenings, but just email us at info@naturetrek.co.uk with your address, and we'll be pleased to pop one in the post to you as soon as possible. And in fact, right now, as we speak, we have our brand new 2021 and 2022 brochure being printed, and it'll be published in just a couple of weeks and landing on doorsteps. And later this year, we hope to get a good number of tours off the ground and get you all traveling again. And we want this session this evening to be interactive, so please do ask any questions you may have by using the Q&A section at the bottom of your screen, be it questions about the tour or the destination, or even questions about how the travel industry is responding to the pandemic. We're happy to chat about all of this. That's what we're here for. So we'll type replies to you throughout the evening if we can, but mainly we'll be reading questions out at 9:05 when we finish the last presentation and we've got time for a chat then. So without any further ado, I'm going to hand you over to our first speaker of this evening, Naturetrek veteran and general manager, Andy Tucker, who's taking us to Peru. Over to you, Andy.
Thanks very much, Sarah. Good evening, everybody. I certainly have got my glass of Argentinian Malbec on hand here to get me in the spirit of things. I hope you're sitting comfortably. It's certainly a surreal experience, this. As Sarah says, we'd normally be out talking face to face with you all and feeding off the energy in a room. So bear with us as we feel our way into this. Myself and Tom and Byron are going to be taking you across to South America this evening, and back to some of our favorite haunts. And as we take you through these images, we'll be reliving some of our life memories and travel experiences. And I hope you can come in spirit with us. To kick off this evening, I will be taking you over to Peru. So just bear with me a second while I share my screen here. I was very fortunate in my early 20s to spend a wonderful year in Peru, working as a guide in the Amazon rainforest down here in the southeast of the country, and I've been back many times since. In fact, when I joined Naturetrek in 1998, my first remit was to bring Naturetrek into the Naturetrek brochure, and I had great fun wondering how I was going to cram all of Peru's highlights into a 2 or 3 week holiday. It's a wonderful country. Here we are on the western seaboard of the South American continent. And you can split Peru up into very distinct ecosystems, which point towards the country's biodiversity. Some very deep sea here, just off Peru's coast, just a short distance off Peru's coast. And the Humboldt Current wells up from Antarctica here, bringing very cold, nutrient-rich water to Peru's coast. So you've got some very rich marine ecosystems along the coast here. Next, moving inland, we meet a very dry and arid and rather desolate coastal strip, followed by the mighty Andes running up north-south down the spine of the country. And moving further east still, we move into these wonderfully biodiverse cloud forests, and then the vastness of the Amazon rainforest, which stretches east, of course, all the way to the Atlantic Ocean, the other side of Brazil. So this talk this evening roughly follows the story of that tour I designed back in 1998, and is still going strong today. The Andes, Peru's macaws and Machu Picchu, although it touches on other aspects of tours we run in Peru, like surf and turf, which is a birding tour in the high Andes, and a mammal tour in the Amazon rainforest. So let's take you through then how this tour unfolds. Lima is a lovely cultural capital, although from a wildlife perspective, not too much happening there. We have to drive south away from the conurbation of Lima. And before too long, we reach these lovely marshlands, Pantanos de Villa, with a nice walking trail and some observation towers. And this offers us a nice gentle introduction to some birding in Peru, with species like great grebe and the aptly named many-coloured rush tyrant. Heading on further south down the Panamericana Highway, we quickly go into this, as I said before, very dry, arid and desolate landscapes. In fact, some of the driest deserts on Earth here, in some cases just over the Chilean border in the Atacama Desert. There has been areas that have received no recordable rainfall ever. So in quite stark contrast to the marine riches offshore. And as we motor south, we're looking for species like Peruvian thickney, which recalls our stone curlew. But the real highlight of this section of the holiday is a visit to the offshore islands. Here we are at the Balestas Islands off the Paracas Peninsula. And you can see by that white colouring there on the rocks that the seabirds nest here in such quantities that quite a deep layer of nitrogen-rich guano builds up. And these structures that you can see there are designed so people can go ashore and sack up the guano to take back to the mainland to use for fertiliser. The boats on the right there are ecotourism boats filled with people like us, our groups, who are there to see the seabirds and the sea lions. And the seabirds, as I said, are here in vast quantities. We're looking for species like Humboldt penguins, one of the world's most beautiful terns, the Inca tern. This is red-legged cormorant. And perhaps most impressively of all, vast colonies of southern sea lions. And it's difficult for me to describe the hit on the senses you get here as you approach one of these colonies. The stench of ammonia in the air, deafening a sound of all of the sea lions grunting. And up in the air there, you can see turkey vultures and odd condors coming down and feeding on carrion and afterbirth and such like. It really is a sensory overload, especially after the long transatlantic flight to get to Lima. Back in on that dry coastal strip, there are oases which are typically centered around rivers which are cascading down from the Andes. And here we can look for very specialist birds like this hummingbird, Amazilia hummingbird, and a splash of color in the coastal desert in the form here of a vermilion flycatcher. Right, heading back to Lima, we're actually flying now over the Andes from west to east. And being aboard a 737 here, you quickly get an idea of how complex the topography of Peru is and what a challenge that is for engineers in terms of road building and railway infrastructure. We soar up out of the coastal mist over the Andes and land one of two frontier towns, Iquitos in the north, but this is Puerto Maldonado in the south of Peru. And that wall of tropical air hits you as you step away from the air-conditioned cabin of the aircraft. Those of you that have visited the tropics probably remember the first sign that you found yourself in a similar situation. It really does hit you like a wall of heat. There are no cars in Puerto Maldonado. The economy is built around tourism, Brazil nut harvesting, gold mining, and in more recent decades, oil exploration. As you can imagine, the habitats around Maldonado are largely deforested, so it's necessary to motor some distance away from town to get into some good wildlife habitats. We're heading upstream here on the River Tambopata. This is a relatively small Amazonian tributary, but by European standards, this would be a gigantic river, a huge discharge, and the level falls and rises by about 30 feet between the wet and dry seasons as the rains fall on the Andes. As we motor away from town, we get into some better habitat, looking for species like capybara, the world's largest rodent. And as we move further away from town, we'll get to see some of the real specialist species that everybody likes to see. Here's a sunbittern, a beautiful bird. But for me, one of the most striking moments of this journey is when we're about 100 miles away from the town, 60 miles away from any permanent human habitation, and traveling west to east, upstream against the current, we gradually see the Andes loom into view. And this is a really desolate region, a pristine region, and it's a real privilege to be here. The substrate of the river changes from mud to rock. So with that, the species start to change. We're looking for birds like this beautiful cap heron. But our goal is deep within the Baja Sonini National Park, where there's this exposed clay cliff. And as the sun strikes the clay cliff in the morning, hundreds, if not thousands of parakeets, parrots and macaws descend on the clay. The clay helps to bind with the toxins in the largely fruit-based diet of these birds. So as the sun rises over our shoulders, one of the world's great ornithological spectacles unfolds before our eyes. And here you've got chestnut-fronted macaws, scarlet macaws, blue and yellow macaws, mealy parrots here, lower centre, there's a blue-headed parrot there, and it really is a wonderful experience to savour. A bit like with the sea lion experience off Peru's coast, a cacophony of noise in the air as these birds come down and feast on the clay. By about 9:30, the show's over. The birds disperse back off into the forest, and we're back to the lodge for bacon and eggs and pancakes, and a day then exploring the rainforest trails. But it's also a place for opportunistic predators. You never know what might turn up on any given morning. This is a different lek, actually, in Manu National Park. And this morning, an ocelot appeared and took a red and green macaw off the clay. But like I say, you never know what might turn up. A king vulture might soar overhead, or a Brazilian tapir might wade across the river. As I said, it's just a privilege to be in such a pristine environment. Along the base of the subtropical Andes here in southeastern Peru and eastern Bolivia, various biodiversity world records have been set in all different taxa, fish and amphibians, butterflies as well. And a technique that the local guides use is, sorry to be a touch crass, but we would urinate onto the sandy beach before the macaw spectacle. And after breakfast, the liquid is evaporated, leaving a bit of a salty deposit on the sand. This is beloved by a whole range of butterflies and day flying moths, as you can see here. After breakfast, we're on top of the clay cliff and exploring the rainforest trails. You can see the Andes there behind. This is September, so the river is right at its lowest, in the height of the dry season, all of the stony banks exposed. And we'll use our time to enjoy some of the other animals and birds in the rainforest, things like red howler monkeys, black spider monkeys, a CITES listed endangered species here, but present in good numbers. There hasn't been any hunting here for many decades. And the birding, for those of you keen birders watching, this probably represents the most challenging birding on the planet. The diversity is high. A lodge like this would have 700 or 800 species plus on its lodge list. But the birds are present in quite low densities and often are quite skulking in their characters. So birds like this white-browed ant bird require a high degree of knowledge of the calls of the vocalizations to get the best from a visit. One morning, this nine-banded long-nosed armadillo walked across the track. And on another occasion, this impressive male tayra, a mammal in the weasel family, appeared on the lodge lawns. treetop tower allows access to the rainforest canopy for flocks of tanagers. And if we're lucky, something like this southern tamandua or collared anteater. And another afternoon will take us off to a secluded oxbow lake, one of my favorite habitats in the lowland Amazon. This was once the main channel of the Tambopata, but in recent years has been encroached, cut off from the main river channel. Eventually, after several decades, if not 100 years or two, will revert to forest. But now, right now, it holds black tannin-rich water, good habitat for piranhas and caimans, and a suite of birds which live around the edge of the Oxbow Lake, such as hoatzin. And if we're lucky, an encounter with a family of giant river otters. Each of these oxbow lakes will be drained by a series of streams, and these habitats are favoured by arguably the world's most stunning species of heron, the agami heron. Quite a large bird, but very secretive and quiet in its behaviour. And the best way to see these birds is to be paddled quietly along one of these rainforest streams by our local guides, and one might just be lurking around the next bend. Right, next we head up into the Andes. So motoring back down river to the airport in Puerto Maldonado, just a short 30 or 45 minute flight up to Cusco, the old Incan capital. Here's the cathedral on the Plaza de Armas. After 5 days or so in the Amazon rainforest, I'm afraid our clothes have absorbed all of the humidity of the rainforest. So it's a quick trip down to the local laundrette to freshen all of those clothes up. And a nice gentle walking tour of Cusco, not forgetting the jump up in altitude here. We're best part of 10,000 feet. So I'm afraid no jogging around or huge consumption of alcohol or caffeine. We must just acclimatize properly to make sure nobody falls foul of the dreaded altitude sickness. Now in Cusco, the streets are thronged with Quechua speaking descendants of the Incas, with their colorful markets selling fruits and vegetables and chickens and bowler hats. In fact, Byron's got a bowler hat. If you're lucky later, he might treat you to putting it on. But fascinating streets to wander around. And you can see centuries old stonework from the dating from the Incan times. There's no binding agents here. This is just pure, excellent stoneworks masonry. And these walls have stood the test of time, numerous earthquakes, and still holding strong. We'll take you to lunch in a traditional Cusqueña restaurant, and hopefully, if all being well, there'll be a band playing the panpipes. And if you just let me indulge myself in the next few seconds, I'll bring this to life for you. Lovely evocative music that, and when you go into a restaurant, the band will come around and sell you a set of panpipes and a CD, and everybody eagerly buys them. By the time you've seen your fifth or sixth band, you're kind of CD'd out. But nevertheless, it's wonderful music, and I sometimes play that at home, and it brings back memories of being in these Andean countries. So once we've seen Cusco and had a rest day, we will strike out into the Andes nearby. On the tourist circuit are the ruins of Pisac above the sacred valley of the Incas. And here we're looking for some very special birds. This is a hummingbird, Andean hill star, and also the Peruvian endemic. This one's called the bearded mountaineer, which I think is a name that could be applied to some Naturetrek tour leaders I know. But a lovely, stunning hummingbird, which is on the sort list of lots of our keener birders. Right, at this stage of the tour, when I first led this tour in 2000, we offered just the Inca Trail. But in more recent years, we've offered a choice here. So the group splits in Cusco. Some will take the Inca Trail to Machu Picchu, and some will spend a few days on the Manu Road down towards Manu National Park, and then we'll reconvene at Machu Picchu itself. The next few slides just give you an indication of what the Inca Trail is like. It's 5 days over 28 miles of rugged terrain. But it's fully serviced camping. We have a lovely Quechua-speaking porter team with us that do all the hard work. And all we have to do is walk from one magical set of ruins to the next as we birdwatch on the way, looking for birds like this chestnut-breasted mountain finch, another proven endemic. This is golden collared tanager, and one or two other hummingbirds. This is Shining Sunbeam. I love that name. It's a gorgeous name. And this is the top of Dead Woman's Pass, the highest point of the Inca Trail. The ruins of Machu Picchu themselves are still 2 days' walk behind those rocky ridges behind us. There's me there with a lovely group halfway down the Inca Trail, just having a fantastic time, having to dig deep at times and sweat, but the views are spellbinding. And as we get lower in altitude down to Machu Picchu, we will see more subtropical and tropical birds like this cock of the rock, a famous, well-known bird that leks in groups in the early morning, a jackdaw-sized crimson bird. And it's a real a must-see experience whenever you're in South America on a birding tour. On the river Urubamba below Machu Picchu, we'll see torrent ducks, another classic bird of the Andes. But the climax of the tour, arguably, are the wonderful ruins of Machu Picchu themselves. In case you're wondering why we've lost a few people since Dead Woman's Pass, there's nothing sinister there. People just arrived early and couldn't wait for a beer in the hotel bar. But there we are, and arriving at the ruins in the late afternoon with that view, well, it just caps those 5 days of hard work and all the bird watching en route. First brought to prominence by Byron Bingham, the American archaeologist, back in 1911. It's undoubtedly a jewel in Peru's crown from a tourism perspective these days. I wager that not many tourists visit Peru for the first time and don't factor in Machu Picchu into their itinerary. It's a glorious setting. There's great guides who can explain a bit about the ruins for us. And it is truly a glorious pinnacle to the tour. I've got a few tips for those of you who would like to visit Machu Picchu. At the moment, of course, with lockdown yesterday, these destinations seem a long reach away, but we will get there eventually. And I can't wait to get back to Peru myself and help some of you with some of your travel plans. So that's Peru. Thank you very much. As Sarah said, there's an opportunity to ask questions in the chat section, and I'll deal with those later. But I hope you've enjoyed that. It just scrapes the surface, really, of a fantastic country. And I will stop sharing my screen now and hand over to my good friend and colleague, Byron, who's going to be talking about his home country of Ecuador, just over the border to the north of Peru, of course. Right, Byron, if you want to get underway and share your screen when you're
ready. Hello, everybody, and welcome to this Naturetrek Roadshow. We're not really a roadshow, unfortunately. As Andy or Sarah mentioned earlier on, it would have been lovely to see and share all this experience face to face. Now, I'm going to talk to you, as Andy has said, about Ecuador. As I've been introduced, I'm Byron Palacios. I'm a Naturetrek wildlife consultant and tour leader, and I've been leading tours all over the place, but obviously Ecuador is the land I belong to, and this is my native country. And, you know, when I'm leading tours around the world, and a lot of people ask me, you know, about Ecuador, and they said, well, how's Ecuador? Well, simply, without putting below the beautiful neighbor countries like Colombia and Peru, Ecuador has got the whole package. It's a small country, 280,000 square kilometers in the northwestern of South America, just a squeeze between Colombia and Peru. And, you know, we've got everything packed in the size of sort of bit bigger than Britain, all this fantastic biodiversity packed in one country, in one land, and the Galapagos Islands, of course, that we'll see that later on, a different, the Galapagos deserves a different separate talk. But anyway, we're gonna talk about the mainland of Ecuador. Ecuador is quite simple. And as you can see here in the map, Ecuador is split in nearly two equal halves by the Andes. That creates a western slope, which is and then by the Pacific Ocean on the west and the eastern slope, which is landed by the Amazon Basin on the east. And I have done this little graphic for you to explain you how things work with the license of Ecuador. So from the very, very high peak, which is a Chimborazo, around 6,310 meters above the sea level, which is the highest point in the country, down to the west Pacific Ocean, or on the west slope, and on the eastern slope, the Amazon Basin. But we have gone through in altitude, within nine life zones, which are main and paramount important for that diversity. And all of them are equally on both sides of the Andes. However, there are variations on the western slope and to the eastern slope. That makes things really, really interesting. There are many, many ways for this reason to start exploring the mainland of Ecuador. And I would say we could start, from our capital, Quito, going to the western slope, or simply the eastern slope, or vice versa. I'm going to take you on this virtual trip to visit the eastern slope first. So after a 30-minute flight from Quito, we will be going down to the Amazon and hitting one of the main towns down there, Francisco de Orellana, well, Coca, which lays right in the River Napo, one of the main tributaries of the Amazon River. And after a very comfortable 2.5-hour trip down to the along this river and down to this lovely wiggling Amazon jungle, we're going to hit many sandbanks and small canals, which, we're still sort of been picking a lot of wildlife already there, and also the interesting impact that the human beings have created along the riverbanks in terms of marketing and trading. Eventually, we're going to arrive to one of these canals way, way down in the inhospitable area of the Amazon and get to our very first lodge for accommodation. Both of our lodges we use now there are pretty comfortable, beautifully setting on Oxbow Lakes generally. And again, it's a fantastic setup of infrastructure, quite basic, I would say. The basic, that means really what we need: clean bed, lovely setting, lovely views, good food for all the variety of tummies and tastes. And it's all to get us ready to start exploring on the following day. And this is what the infrastructure of these places have allowed us to do. Canopy towers, canopy walks like this one, which allow us to explore the forest from the top, from the canopy. There are three ways to do it, and this is one of them. So in order to start doing this from either canopy walks or beautifully built canopy towers, once on top, 40 meters maybe from the ground, it will be a great and one of the best opportunities to spot any sort of wildlife, starting from fantastic colorful birds like these paradise tanagers, ringneck woodpecker, white-neck puffbird, many-banded arasaris, toucans, monkeys, all sorts of things exploring from these very, very top of the tower. Once we're going down the ground, another way to explore this reserve or this Amazon rainforest is by drifting down in very quietly on paddling boats. And this will allow us to stop at any time we spot something nice like this beautiful white-eyed night monkeys, which could be seen during the day if our very knowledgeable native guides know where they pernoctate and sleeping. This is a beautiful family that I'm always nice to see, plus other primates. In fact, nearly 12 species of monkeys can be seen in this trip. some of them rarer than others. For example, we have pygmy marmosets, we have Ecuadorian monsaki, and the beautiful endemic golden mantle tamarin, which we can see it fairly easy. It's an endangered species, but they're doing very, very, very well in that bank of the River Napo. Moving down to the very quiet looking, but yet really, really active and full of life, oxbow lakes. Again, drifting either by foot, on foot, or on this paddling board. We're lucky enough we can encounter some of their silent habitats, like this neotropical otter. But we're very lucky, but more likely, these chaps, giant river otters, are going to be seen really, really loud and fishing, really confident fishing in front of you once they're after their food. And it's a fantastic, fantastic animal. We're also going to have the chance to visit one of the local clay lakes, which allows all species of parrots to lay down and take some minerals from these wet clay lakes, which is a spectacle to see. Very noisy. We're going to be obviously very, very quiet, really, really noisy, but we can see all this colorful display of gorgeousness in such a small piece of this ravine, and it's one of the highlights of the tour. Leaving the Amazon behind, and again, there's plenty more stuff to see down there. Leaving the Amazon behind, either driving for a good 4 to 5 hours by car, or taking a plane back to Quito, we're going to encounter and explore the eastern slope going up to the highlands. We're going to pass, remember, many different habitats on that way, which allow us to find many other different wildlife. Every layer of altitude, 100 meters, 200 meters, we're gaining altitude, is going to be a different landscape, and therefore different wildlife to see, like this beautiful mountain, black-billed mountain toucan. Also torrent ducks along the whitewater rivers, until we hit the beautiful mountains of the highlands. And if we're lucky enough to see, and it's clear to see, these beautiful volcanoes or snow caps like Cotopaxi or Antisana, this is where we're going to be sort of be exploring around the Antisana mountain. Now, amongst these mountain forests and subtropical, upper subtropical forests, we are going to move to the elephant forest and Paramo as well. Beautiful evergreen, full of water habitats, which compile all sort of a variety of wildlife. As soon as you start walking along one of the trails, you can hit a flock of birds with full of these guys, these beautiful mountain tanagers we have. I know they'll look sort of less the same, with the exception of the scarlet belly mountain tanager, one in red and the top right. But we have hooded mountain tanager, mask mountain tanager, which is a near endemic, buff-breasted mountain tanager, lacrimose mountain tanager, you name it. It's a very noisy and really, really great to see when they come along in flock. Also, other more elusive, but nevertheless not that quiet inhabitants, like these lovely anpetas, Tony anpeta, Rufus anpeta, and also very specialized birds like blackback bush tanagers and giant cornbills that specialize in this beautiful, beautiful woodland of polylepis trees or paper trees that is fantastic to see, fantastic to see. Also, we have bigger wildlife down there, very interesting. Spectacle bear or Andean bear, beautiful animal, doing quite well. And actually, we've been lucky enough to see a few of these during our tours down in this area of the Andes. Pumas or American cougar are a possibility. They're always difficult to see because they're nocturnal mainly, but you never know. As I always say, as long as you're in the habitat, you've got chances. plus Andean coatis and plenty other Andean fox, plenty other mammals to see, mountain tapir, you name them. Now, another specialties, and this is one thing that you are likely to see, is this beautiful hummingbird, sword-bill hummingbird. Imagine a hummingbird owner of a beak larger than his own body. It's a phenomenal sample of how magnificent nature is, and we're very likely to see this beautiful hummingbird, plus many others. Again, the accommodation, really good. After a long day exploring and enjoying the wildlife of the place, going back to these beautiful hot springs, it's a huge reward. We're all looking forward to that. I mean, I'm just looking at it and getting really, really want to jump through the screen and jump into that beautiful hot springs or thermals. And sometimes with beautiful views of the snow caps out there. The accommodation as well down in the mountain forest is again very basic, but really cozy, really comfy. And the food is also to die for. Now, let's go to and move further afield, now going to the western slope of the Andes. Again, going from the Andes, descending towards the western slope, we're going to the descending altitude through the interandean valleys, where we can make a few stops along the way and a sort of couple of hours drive, making a few other stops, birding stops or wildlife stops, which allows us to see some of the inhabitants of this area. Beautiful little things like this purple colored woodstart, the largest hummingbird of the world, the giant hummingbird, magnificent hummingbird, nearly the size of a house martin, or maybe the size of a house martin, impressive bird. As soon as we hit down in altitude, we hit mountain forest and eventually the subtropical forest or upper subtropical forest, or cloud forest as we call them, which again is going to be throwing at us a lot of their colorful and beautiful birds, like this toucan barbet, this orange-breasted fruit eater, colorful tanagers, and this gorgeous cock of the rocks. We're going to visit specifically legs of this beautiful bird, which it's outstanding to be seen. Again, toucan barbets eating really close in the fruit feeders nearby. The magnificent plate-billed mountain toucan, one of the Ecuador's or the regional endemic birds, which is amazing to see, has all these mountain toucans have this incredible trumpet-like call that actually made us stop. It's like a warehouse alarm. Amazing, amazing animals. Red-headed barbet, another gorgeous, colorful bird. And as soon as we are exploring more sort of in detail inside the or into the woods, into this beautiful collage of greenness and mist of the forest, we're going to hit some of the more colorful inhabitants belonging to the Trogon family, quetzals. We've got three species of quetzals in Ecuador, one of them in the Amazon, but the other two, both of the Andean slopes, crested and golden-headed, fairly easy to see. And once we got in our telescope, wow, it's just as colorful as these beautiful birds, and more colorful tanagers, more black-capped tanager, golden tanager, glittering green tanager, rufous-throated tanager. They all come in the lodges where they have bird feeders, bird tables. If not seen in flocks in our walks, we could catch up with them easily on our breaks, when they take our breaks in the different lodges. All of them complemented by beautiful hummingbirds. Ecuador is owner of more than 140 species of hummingbirds, and we're going to at least see 60 species. We're targeting 60 species in a regular visit of two of the Andean slopes. Again, amazing, amazing birds that we're going to blow our minds, and also a lot of memory in our cameras, because we'll never stop photographing they're different catching, you know, when the light catches their plumage, it depends if the light is catching them. The colors completely vary, which is amazing animals. And you could, as I said, have fun and a good time sitting down or simply watching them or photographing them, loads of them. Mammals as well are huge possibilities, like this taira or cabeza de mate or mate head. And also one of the recent additions in the neotropical mammal is this is Olingito, recently discovered in the first decade of the 2000s, and it can be potentially seen this tree. Again, the accommodations for this part of the tour, fantastic, really comfy, really simple, as you said, as I said. And as you can see, bedrooms quite basic, but comfortable, cozy, fantastic food. And I would say, again, for all sort of tastes and tummies. Once back to our capital, Quito, will be a good time to catch up with ourselves, have a good wander of around the city, visiting the highlights of the colonial churches in the old town, or the middle of the world, or why not paying a visit to the Otavalo market, where you know, you could have a bit of a relax, seeing all the trading of this wonderful tribe can have to offer. And why not the drivings and all the landscape driving across this fantastic country can be enjoyed at every minute. Don't forget that Naturetrek also runs more tours down the southwest coast of Ecuador and the Tumbesian area, and also down in the southeast. And remember that we proudly support our Naturetrek reserve down in the central eastern slope of the central Andes, a very, very important corridor which is linking two of the very important national parks down there in Ecuador, which is Yanganates National Park and Sangay National Park. And Naturetrek has been taking a huge, huge part by purchasing a lot of land to complete this corridor, and is creating a huge, huge natural helpful for and to protect a lot of the species that have been already described to science. So it's been amazing. It's not this carbon footprint money from your contribution while traveling with us. This is, I would love to spend the whole night and show you even more about this beautiful country. So I really hope to see you one day, either there or if you go without me, just enjoy, because I'm sure you're going to be in good hands with one of my colleagues down there. And I'm really, really hope you enjoyed and this fantastic gem of the of South America.
Great, thank you very much, Byron. Wow, some rather dizzying heights of the canopy tower there that you were showing us up in the canopy. That's fantastic. Right, everyone, we're going to have a short interval now, and we'll rejoin at 25 minutes past 8, where Tom will be taking us to Guyana. So we'll catch up with you in 10 minutes' time. Thank you.
And it's gone already.
Thank you.
Right, well, welcome back, everybody. And I hope you managed to go and get yourselves another drink and are sitting comfortably. And I'm now going to hand you over to my colleague, Tom Mabbett, who is going to take you to Guyana. Over to you, Tom.
Great stuff. Thank you, Sarah. Okay, everybody. Good evening. Hope you enjoyed your break. If you just bear with me one moment, I'll just share my screen with you. I actually had a slight technical issue, so my slideshow for the moment isn't there, but if you just bear with me 2 moments, I'll just bring that up. Just when you don't want a computer meltdown, for the first time in ages, it happened right at the end of Byron's talk.
It wouldn't be a Zoom webinar without at least one technical hitch, I think, Tom.
You're doing so well. I'll be up and running in a moment. It was ready in the background, my talk, but the computer crash has got rid of it. So I'll be back on track any moment now.
Well, we've got lots of questions that have been coming in during the interval. We will be making sure we answer all of those at the end when we finished our last presentation at 9:05. We've answered a few already. But we will be answering all of those at the end. And Tom, Byron and Andy are happy to chat through any of those questions.
Okay, so we're getting there. We're getting there. Brilliant. Okay. Almost there. Okay, I'll just share my screen with you and then we can get going. Fantastic, we're there. Sorry folks for the hold up there. And thanks very much for bearing with me. Welcome again, everyone. My name's Tom Mabbett. I'm an operations manager for Naturetrek, and I look after a whole range of tours, ranging from weekends in the UK, week-long tours in the UK as well, across Europe, South America, Asia. And I'm very lucky that I get to go out and lead lots of these tours as well. So it's a fantastic role. Since joining Naturetrek, I've been lucky enough to get out and lead over 50 tours now, including getting out to the wonderful country of Guyana. So for the next 20 minutes or so, I'm going to run through our tour to this remote wilderness and just what makes a visit so very special. So I'll start with where is Guyana and how do we get there? So it's in the northeastern South America, bordering Suriname, Venezuela, and Brazil to the south. And we fly on a direct flight with BA to Trinidad, and from there we take a Caribbean Airways flight from Trinidad into the capital, Georgetown, which is on the coast. So I've just zoomed in here a little more on the geography. So we start with a night in Georgetown, and then really head on to the interior the following day. It's a spectacular tour, and there's really one road that runs through the heart of Guyana, the famous Linden to Lethem Road. And that's the road that we'll be traveling along and stopping at lodges along the way. Guyana has a tropical equatorial climate, similar climate that you've been hearing from Byron in the last talk. So it's hot and humid throughout the year. The rainy season in the interior, it's the interior of the country where we're spending most of our time, that's May to August, and we time our visits. We visit in November and February, and it works very well visiting then. So after a night in Georgetown, we take a chartered flight to Kaito Falls, and this is the world's largest single drop waterfall. The tour really starts with a bang. You're flying over endless rainforest, and then all of a sudden, this incredible waterfall comes into view. It really is a very special sight. It's on the Pataro River. The waterfall is 226 meters high. that's four times the height of Niagara, around twice the height of Victoria Falls. And it's just a...
Tom, sorry, I don't want to interrupt you, but your slideshow isn't full screen. Are you able to hide presenter view? And then we'll be able to see it full screen for people. Just got a few comments here that people aren't seeing it full screen. We can see your notes.
Oh, sorry.
That's all right.
How do I?
If you click on those three dots, I think it should perhaps.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Or if you just go full screen from there.
What have I done now? Sorry about that. I thought that was.
There you go. Yeah, that's great.
Okay. Okay, that's great.
Yeah, perfect.
No problem.
Yeah, it's full screen now for everyone. Sorry to interrupt. Fantastic. Thank you.
That's great. So yeah, we fly on and experience the force. So at this point, I will state that all the photos that I'm using throughout this presentation are all taken by either myself or members of the or group members. So we then land at the Kaito Falls National Park and have time to explore on foot. So we have around 2 hours to walk around the park and just take in the majestic falls, essentially. So you'll see here there's no barriers or tourist outlets or anyone else here. It would just be our group with time to take in the falls and find wildlife. There's some stat where I think there's more visitors there's more people visit Machu Picchu in a day than visit Guyana and the Kaito National Park in a whole year. So it's a very special place and you really feel privileged to be here. Now this is one very special inhabitant. This is the golden rocket frog. And this species is found only in the large tank bromeliads found at the top of the Kaito National Park. And with careful checking in these bromeliads, we'll find this very special species. Views, spectacular views, are found throughout Guyana. And the thing that struck me was just, you're looking at some, endless rainforest, and you just think, well, no one ever has explored this fantastic wilderness. And it's quite breathtaking. 80% of the country is still covered in forest. So that's largely lowland tropical forest, but also sort of montane, higher altitude forest. There's sort of tupui in the background of the photo there. And it really is breathtaking views wherever you look. So once we've had our fill of the falls and have some incredible views, we take to the air again and just fly for about another half an hour to our first lodge. And this is Ewok Rama Research Station, based on the Essequibo, the longest river in Guyana. It's a fantastic place to start the tour. Lots of trails leading off into the forest, perfect for getting out on the river and exploring by boat. And everything studied here, from the smallest creatures and the plants and the trees, right up to the larger mammals. And it's a super place. This is scarlet macaw, just one of many species we can find, along with blue and gold, red and green macaws, various different parrots and parakeets. This is a crimson-backed woodpecker. There's lots of other woodpecker species we can find, and a whole host of trogons and tanagers. Lots and lots of different species we can find just walking the trails. The guides often know where manakin leks are. These cracking little birds, the males will gather in lekking sites and hop around on the branches, displaying to females and trying to attract their attention. And again, this is quite a grainy photo. This is one of mine. As was mentioned earlier, it's very difficult sometimes to take photos in dense tropical rainforests. It's one of the most difficult habitats to do that. There's some spectacular species, and we'll walk the trails, hoping to come across mixed flocks. And when we do, it's incredibly exciting. And this white-throated toucan, so they often give these a sort of a loud yelping call from these exposed branches, and they're rather common. as we explore the trails around the lodge. And I always include a snake slide in my presentations. And this is the famous fur de lance pit viper, incredible camouflage. And if you've got a phobia of snakes, you needn't worry, you're not going to be seeing them all the time. But if you are interested, the guides usually know where they hang out, and it's a privilege to see some of these amazing species. And this is just a photo of just getting out on the Essequibo and just cruising around, enjoying the wildlife and whatever we can find out on the riverways. It might be a neotropical otter, giant otters are found here, a paradise jacamar maybe feeding in the riverside vegetation, a king vulture cruising overhead. The possibilities really are endless, and it's a lovely way to explore the area. You need a vehicle like this really to travel through Guyana. That Linden to Lethem road, it's not really a road, it's more of a dirt track. The time of year we visit, the road will be dry, and it's very, very passable. You're not bumping around too much, and we've never had any trouble with passing it. You've got to be prepared for some adventure traveling to Guyana. The lodges aren't lavish, they're fairly basic in nature, and there's journeys and vehicles like this, but it's brilliant for, your reward is visiting some of the most pristine untouched habitats on the planet, really. So moving on, we stay within the rainforest. As you move south, you slowly come out onto the sort of savannas and open ground further south, but we spend a further 3 nights at a rainforest lodge, fantastic little lodge, completely surrounded by rainforest. Lovely family-run lodge. They welcome you like you're their family when you arrive here. And again, just the sound of the rainforest is all around you and wildlife everywhere. Black curassow, they walk out of the forest onto the lawns around the lodge, giving some fantastic views. And again, as Byron mentioned in his talk, a fantastic way to see the rainforest is getting up high, getting up onto these canopy walkways. And it's just a very special experience to be up there, sort of at first light, and just listening to the sounds, listening to the jungle waking up. And there's a whole host of species you can see here, some special birds, pompadour catinga, Guyanan toucanet, Guyanan puffbird, just to name a few. There's often howler monkeys around and capuchins. An incredible amount of diversity and wildlife can be seen when you get up in amongst the canopy. As I mentioned, this is a red howler monkey, and the noise of these animals is really amazing. You're led in your bed in the morning, and when it's still just getting light, I hear this incredible roaring sound of these howler monkeys. It's quite amazing. They're very frequently seen exploring the trails, and you can very good chance of seeing this amazing animal. This photo is a photo of a paw print of a jaguar. And I'll be honest, this is usually as close as you'll get to seeing a jaguar in Guyana. But we have had success. In fact, we had a group out there in February, just before the lockdown, and they had an incredible encounter with a jaguar actually on the same trail as them at a lodge, and just 20 meters ahead crossing the track. So wonderful sighting. But if your heart is set on seeing jaguar, it's really Brazil and the Pantanal that you should be heading to. But we have had success. Not too far from Atta is a breeding site for this spectacular bird. So this is the Guyanan cock of the rock. So it's the cousin of the Andean cock of the rock that Andy was showing you earlier. And the Guyanan cock of the rock is just slightly brighter orange. Some amazing feathering on its back there. And they're just remarkable birds. And again, the males will come together at Lex and display and hope to attract a female. It's really a case of spot the bill here with these. It's sort of buried in amongst the underneath this comb of feathers. They're absolutely spectacular. And they get their name, they nest in these rocky outcrops in the forest. So it's a wonderful walk through the forest, and you get to the rocky outcrops, and that's where you'll find this amazing bird. Any walk through the forest, you've got a chance to come across primates. These are range restricted and endangered red-faced spider monkeys. We were walking to the cock of the rock site, and this trooper really noisy crashing around overhead, The animal on the right-hand side here was just shaking on these vines and branches, and they really weren't happy with our presence. And you can see the little youngster clinging onto mum here, so we quickly moved on. Beautiful butterflies. This is one of the morpho species. It's amazing metallic blue. And it's, they'll just be flitting through the forest. This amazing flashes of blue, lots of different butterfly species. And we're really taking in everything. We're spending a lot of time searching for the birds, as they're most numerous, of course, but we're also always searching for mammals, which is the main sort of highlight if you manage to find them, and taking in the plants, the trees, the insects, everything really. So leaving the rainforest, we'll have spent 5 days in absolutely pristine, untouched rainforest. Very few visitors. We'd like to be the only people at the lodges. And we move on to Sarama Eco Lodge. And it's really an eco village. It's a handful of families live here. There's a very small school. It's a fantastic place. And again, they welcome you with open arms. They rely pretty much entirely on tourism here. The children want to grow up and be wildlife guides, and it's a fantastic place. We're just coming onto the savannah and the open grassland here. So there's patches of open ground and then forest, as you can see in the background there. And a whole different suite of species, of course. This here we have burrowing owl, quite frequently seen here. Buff-necked ibis and southern lapwing striding across the more open grassland. And we still have the sort of signature Amazonian species flying between these pockets of forest here. These are red and green macaws. We have an opportunity from Sarama to head into the forest to visit a harpy eagle nest. So you can maybe just about see here, this mass of twigs here is a harpy eagle nest. And they will choose an emergent tree such as this kapok tree to build their nest. It's a huge structure. And they'll often use the same nest site year after year, adding to it. So that site just gets huge. And actually the skull of a monkey was hanging out the side of this one when we were there, quite amazing. So we hope to find them. The young birds will hang around the nest often for up to a year after they fledge. So we're really aiming to see a fully grown young bird, and we need a bit of luck on our side for an adult. But we have a very good success rate with seeing harpy eagle on our Guyana tours, and the guides know where to head to. This is a shot of an amazing adult harpy eagle taken on our tour. Back to the mammals, white-faced saki, another special species we hope to find as we're exploring the trails and scanning the canopy from the grounds. We had this one earlier in the evening. I'm not going to complain about showing it twice. The beautiful, stunning vermilion flycatcher, cracker that's found out in these more open areas. And birds just around the lodge, some of the scavenging species, yellow-headed caracara and black vulture here. And this is a view over the savannah. And so this is natural progression. There's no sort of deforestation or any loss of forest. It's just the way that the habitat changes as you move south through the country. And we want to cover all the habitats on our tour. So we travel some distance along this road. So from Sarama, we head out over this plain to Karanambu Lodge. So we have to travel by overland and then by boat along the Rupununi River to reach Karanambu. So Karanambu was a working ranch, but now is purely for ecotourism. It's a wonderful mix of open savanna. It has around 30 miles of river within the lodge grounds, which we'll be exploring. And just a fantastic array of species and a wonderful way to sort of end our visit to the interior. One of the most special species is without doubt the giant anteater. Certainly one of my favourite species. I've been lucky to see them in Guyana and in Brazil. Wonderful species. We'll head out very early in the morning and just head out onto the savannah and scan the area and work hard to find them. And then we have excellent success rates, and they do very well here. Again, there's very few visitors. There's very little human pressure in Guyana. It's the sort of the feeling you have throughout your visit is of sort of exclusivity. So these amazing animals will be trundling around, hoovering up termites. They're said to be consuming around 35,000 ounces of termites a day. And almost half their body seems to be this amazing bushy tail, which is perfect for providing shade in the, you know, to protect them from the sun. And also in the cooler nights, they can wrap up in this tail to keep warm. So a fantastically adapted creature that we make a big effort to find. And again, we're spending time on the river. So a lot of this tour is spent watching wildlife from boats, wonderfully relaxing, special way to watch wildlife in these parts. And often the best way, rather than being in the habitat, you're sort of watching it from the river, and looking at the sort of the overhanging trees and finding all sorts of special species. And again, this is just a shot to show the you know, just the lack of people and full of wildlife. You're very unlikely to come across other boats. It's quite amazing. You just really feel so far away from human habitation, and you really are. It's some of the most remote areas on the planet that we can visit. This is, you know, sandback here as a spectacle caiman there, and various herons and egrets and storks. There could be an otter around the corner. Who knows? Here's a close-up of a black caiman, the largest member of the alligator family. So Guyana is really a land of giants. This is the largest of the alligator family. We have giant river otters, the largest mustelid in the world. We have arapaima here, which is one of the largest freshwater fish. I've already mentioned giant anteater and harping eagle. So there's some spectacular species. This chap was about 5 meters long, and one of the largest that we managed to find when I was there. Spectacular species. And Karanambu was home to the legendary Diane McTurk, who was famous for rehabilitating orphaned giant river otters. Diane sadly passed away in 2016, but the lodge still takes in some young orphaned giant otters. And I include this photo just to show the size of giant otters. They're absolutely huge, you know, growing over a meter long. This huge, this long paddle-like tail, really, really special species. And some fantastic work. Thankfully, it's not such a problem now. There's far fewer orphaned otters that are brought in, and there's a good population in the rivers around there. And they know the importance of them for visiting tourists. Here's a photo of two wild animals. They're very wary. They don't see many people. It's not like when you visit the Pantanal, they're very used to lots of boats. In Guyana, they're quite skittish. It's very unusual. They're not used to seeing boats. So we have a very good track record of finding them. And the expert local guides know where they're hanging out. So a very special species to catch up with. We saw an adult agami heron in Andy's talk. This is a juvenile creeping through the edge of the river, vegetation at the edge of the river here. A whole range of kingfishers, Amazon kingfisher here. We also see green kingfisher, ringed, American pygmy kingfisher. Spectacular range of different bird species. This is the bizarre capuchin bird. It really does have a bald head. And again, they'll gather in leks as well, and make this really bizarre. It's very difficult to describe, sort of a mooing, some wow wow call that the males will call to attract a mate. Fairly range restricted species, this one. It's found directly around the lodge, so we'll make an effort to catch up with that. The guides often know where various different species of nightjar are roosting, ladder-tailed nightjar, blackish nightjar, various different species. And I think one of my favourite experiences here is going out at dusk and getting onto these, you know, tiny little sort of oxbow lakes where the giant water lilies are found. Quite a spectacular lily. They've often got striated herons and capped herons walking over them. It's a fantastic experience to be there at dusk when the flowers open, beetles come in to pollinate them. And it's wonderful. It's one of those moments you really think, wow, I am in such a remote area of the world, and just feel privileged to be there. So that sort of ends our time in the interior with the three nights at Karanambu, exploring from that very, very special lodge, which has welcomed many famous guests over the years. Karanambu was actually made famous by Attenborough, who visited as part of his Zoo Quest series, and then since then has had lots and lots of well-known visitors. So we finish with three nights there, and then we have two nights back in Georgetown. So we fly on a scheduled flight, so a slightly larger plane than we use on our journey into the interior, and we'll head back and just explore the coast a little bit, experience Georgetown, do some birding along the Demerara River, to try and see such special species as scarlet ibis here and hawatzin, it's actually Guyana's national bird. And we'll head to a back street cafe and have a sample some fine Guyanan cuisine, head to the botanical gardens where we have the chance to see manatees in the river there and search for some very range restricted birds, such as blood-coloured woodpecker and various other species. And enjoy the seeing the city a little as well as we drive through it to our hotel. So that's our time in Guyana. So finished. We'll then after those two nights, that'll be time to leave and head on our way home. But I'll just have a couple of slides here just to show you. We're traveling through Trinidad, as I mentioned as I mentioned at the start. So it's well worth tagging on a night or two if you can at the Asia Wright Centre. Some fantastic birding. They'll put fruit out for the banana quits and honey creepers, as you can see here. And a really nice way just to relax after your time in Guyana with some very easy, spectacular birding. Lots of different hummingbird species to be seen feeding on feeders and some fantastic photographic opportunities. So I'll just finish my talk with a view of untouched, pristine wilderness and primary rainforest. And that really sums up what Guyana is all about. Very, very few visitors, a whole host of special species, and just every step along the journey, you're just wowed by the views and just the feeling of being somewhere where very few people visit. So I hope you've enjoyed it. Sorry about the hiccups and the hitches in the at the start there, but without further ado, I'll stop sharing my screen and I'll pass you on to Andy, who's going to talk to you about Colombia.
Thank you very much, Tom. Great to hear about Guyana. Right, to finish the evening, we're heading back into the Andes and Colombia, another one of my favorite countries. For a lot of my time in the travel industry, from 1996 or so onwards, Colombia has been largely out of bounds. But as you mostly will know, it's got more bird species than any other country on the planet. So for keen birders, it really is a mecca. You're going to want to go there at some point in your lifetime. And the diversity is largely down to just the sheer spread of different habitats. The Andes, once they come over the Colombian border from Ecuador, split into three different ranges, each with their own microclimates and ecosystems. And we've also got one of the world's most isolated mountain areas up here in the Sierra Nevada de Santa Marta, with a huge range of endemic species in that mountain range. So this talk follows two of our bargain tours, the multicolored Tanager tour, which explores the area of Cali down here in the southwest of Colombia. Then we work our way up the Cauca Valley, exploring the western and central Andes, and end up in the Santa Marta range in the north. But we also run a mammal trip in Colombia, and also a bit more of a relaxed birds and history tour, which will appeal to those of you who like to do some birding, but don't necessarily want to be up at the crack of dawn and birding hard for 14 hours a day. You also want to see some of the rich culture and heritage of these countries. So that birds and history tour is for you. Now, laying aside for a moment the current pandemic, which has got us all on hiatus, pre-pandemic, the travel outlook for Colombia looked like this. This was lifted from the Foreign Office website. And like I say, for the majority of my time in the travel industry, you would have seen the whole of Colombia either red or orange. So the Foreign Office advising against all travel or advising against non-essential travel. But from about 2014-15 onwards, the country has opened up. These green areas encompass many of Colombia's top birdwatching sites. And I took the opportunity back in 2015 to go over to Colombia and explore it in detail with a view to bringing it back into the Naturetrek brochure. And I was really bowled over with the warm welcome, the sense of security that I felt, the wonder, and the habitats were all absolutely spellbinding. And I came back full of enthusiasm, and Colombia's been a great destination for us ever since. So for any of you wondering about going to Colombia, will you feel insecure? If you've seen the Narcos series on Netflix, you might travel with some trepidation, but it's such a welcoming, hospitable country these days. Let's hope it emerges from the pandemic with its thriving, or thriving tourism industry intact. Some great accommodation. We'll fly into Bogota overnight, a direct flight from London. That's one advantage of traveling to Colombia. If you go to Georgetown or Lima or Quito, we have to change en route when we come from the UK, but there's a direct flight down to Bogota, an overnight flight. And we just hop on a short connecting flight down to Cali and then up into the hills. And this is our lovely base for the first few nights at Araucana Lodge. You can bird from your bedroom until your heart's content here. Red-headed barbit down there in the bottom left, acorn woodpecker, and Dayan emerald, that bird on the right there. The star of this region of Colombia, and it's a bird we actually named a tour after, the multicolored tanager. The place to see this is at a noted birding site called simply KM18. It's one of the old survey sites that they surveyed 100 or more years ago. Just on the highway out of Cali, down on the road to Buenaventura, there's a lovely little cafe and farm called Finca Alejandría. And you can go there, have a picnic lunch, and there are bird tables laden with tropical fruits. And the multicolored tanager will come down, as will flocks of other birds. And it's a great introduction to Colombian birding. Cameras are clicking away. And this is what I call one of those set piece birding opportunities. You rock up in your minibus or Land Rover, get out, sit on a comfortable bench with your cameras, and the birds come to you. You don't have to work for it at all. This is in stark contrast to when I was leading a lot of tours in South America between about 1998 and 2002, when we didn't really have any active feeding stations available at all. It was more traditional hard work birding, rucksack on your back, cloud forest trail, and see what flocks you come across. Whereas a lot of birding tours these days offer a mix between set piece photography-based birding and get a rucksack on your back and head off into the hills. And I personally really enjoy that mix. But coming down to the tables here, birds like golden tanager and golden naped tanager on the right there, and great habitat all around as far as the eye can see. Some fantastic cloud forest to enjoy. White-tailed hillstar will come readily down to feeders in this area. But it's the tanagers. People ask me what my favourite neotropical birds are. I think I'd always say the Tangara tanagers, the rufous-throated tanagers in the foreground here. Part of my favourite family also on this table are silver-throated tanagers, those bright yellow birds, and a lemon-rumped tanager in the background there with a shiny beak. And one of my favourite birds, Byron touched on the mountain tanagers in Ecuador, and a similar diverse range can be enjoyed in Colombia. This is black-chinned mountain tanager, a speciality of the Western Andes, coming readily down to fruit. Quetzals, I think someone in the comments wrote, thought quetzals were only present in Central America. Probably the most well-known quetzal is the resplendent quetzal of Costa Rica and the environs with those wonderful long streamer tail feathers. But there are several other family members of this family through the Americas. And one of the most common is golden-headed quetzal. And we can see this easily in the Western Andes of Colombia and Ecuador. One of the things that surprised me when I was in Colombia was the emphasis that local authorities put on their natural environment with well-constructed signs translated into English. There's clearly a lot of pride with their natural heritage. And although you can see there, it's not particularly well translated here, but they're basically saying only 4% of Colombia's indigenous cloud forest is left. Although that's a stark statistic, what I found when I was there is that remaining 4% is essentially ring-fenced and very well protected. There's a great sense of national pride. And pro-export Colombia, the body behind encouraging tourism in Colombia, is very keen on aviotourism, ornithological tourism, and wider realm of ecotourism. And that was really heartening to see. Having talked about the very comfortable accommodation down near Cali, our next destination up at Montezuma Reserve is a bit more rickety, in inverted commas. But sometimes to go to these bird-rich places, I say to people, you've got to do what it takes. And if that means just a dribble of hot water coming out of your shower and kind of rustic stroke basic accommodation, well, you know, put up with it for a couple of nights, because the birding in these kinds of areas will very much be worth it. So this is Montezuma Lodge, a basic structure. The proprietor, that lady there, is Michelle, a very keen birder, a very, very hot birder as well. She's very sharp on her vocalizations and birding. And she would accompany us to the top of the mountain after a 4 o'clock wake up in the morning. And then we'll spend the rest of the day birding down the trail all the way back to the lodge. When I was here, it was really one of the best days birding of my life. So 4 o'clock wake up, an hour and 20 minutes or so, very rough ride up on some very stout four-wheel drive vehicles to the hilltop. There's a military station just off to the right here, and we're looking across the valley there to the wilds of Tatamá National Park. And you can quite believe that lots of that area that you can see in the valley opposite has never been touched by a human footprint. It really is quite breathtaking wilderness. So we'll have a breakfast of fresh Colombian coffee and scrambled eggs and pancakes. And then we'll simply, on foot, partly riding in a Jeep, just work our way back down the mountainside, birding as we go. And it's absolutely fantastic birding with a nice mix of Colombian endemics and a more widespread but sought after Andean species. The road is quite rough on the way up. You need to think carefully about any bad backs before committing to a tour like this, but it really is spellbinding birding once we're up there. Another one of my favourite birds, the purplish mantled tanager, the orange-breasted fruit eater. And just look at that for scenery. There's just unbroken, pristine cloud forest as far as the eye can reach. And for those of us concerned about deforestation and global warming, to realise there are still scenes like that in the Andes is heartening, and to have a regime that's intent on protecting that even more so. Halfway down, our lunch will come up on a motorbike from Michelle's lodge, and we'll rest our feet and relax in the middle part of the day, just catch our breath and go through the morning sightings before in the afternoon we continue on with the birding. Chestnut-breasted chlorofolia. And some of the key species on this mountainside, some of the ones that the birders will really be keen to tick off, the Colombian endemics, the gold-ringed tanager, and the black and gold tanager, both endemic to Colombia. We normally reach the lodge at about 2 or 3 in the afternoon, and for anyone struggling with time on their feet or getting miles under their belts, the Land Rover can shuttle us back and forth down the mountainside. But whether you walk all the way down or whether you get a part lift, we'll be back down at the lodge to enjoy Michelle's hummingbird feeders about 3 o'clock in the afternoon with a well-deserved cold beer and well over 100 species under our belts. It's funny when we don't listen to each other's slideshows before the talk. I'm never quite sure what Tom and Byron are going to be including. Byron's touched on this animal in his talk on Western Ecuador, the olinguito, as Byron said, only recently described. But present here at Montezuma Lodge, and it will come down readily for bananas after dark. We next skip in a westerly direction over the Cauca Valley to Otunquimbaya, a research station nestling in a valley at the foot of the Andes. I pictured torrent ducks below Machu Picchu, but this is another perfect spot to look for this emblematic species. It's amazing to see these birds in the torrent. If you come across a family of torrent ducks with the tiny chicks, and to see them battling against what from a human perspective are quite fearsome grade 4 and grade 5 rapids. It really is a sight to behold. And when I fly home from these tours, I always like to do a top 10 birds of the trip, kind of vote in the airport on the way home once we've all checked in, and torrent ducks always come out in the top 10. Otton Kimbayo is known as the best place in the world probably to see red ruffed fruit crow, a real speciality here, as well as crested ant tanager, Calcutwan, and a bunch of other specialities. From Otton Kimbayo, we can strike out into the high Andes. Byron's touched on the Paramo ecosystem in Ecuador. So we're above the tree line here, above the subtropical zone. And the Paramo is a Spanish word which basically indicates open moorland, very wet weather, frozen conditions at night, and getting on for 4,000 meters of altitude. So we'll drive up here in the morning, have a couple of cups of coca tea, which helps to combat the thin air, and we'll enjoy the scenery. This is typical Paramo scenery, sodden underfoot, these big bromeliad type plants and espalicia, those big tall plants, a member of the sunflower family. They collect rainwater or mist, and the water funnels down the trunks, and it all helps to conserve the water ecosystem in the Andes. And that's just part of the wider scenery here with the espalicia plants, just there to give you a sense of perspective. That's Nevada Ruiz in the background there. Back in the 1980s, this was a site of a catastrophic explosion where the town beneath the volcano was swamped with meltwater and mud, a great cost of life. But the Colombian authorities, you would hope, have learned from that. And construction of towns in those river valleys is now very much avoided. Some of the species we're looking for up here would include buffy helmet crest. And we'll move down to some lovely thermal springs for lunch with all of the attendant hummingbird feeders. Those of you packing swimming costumes, swimming trunks, can have a dip in the heavenly hot water here, but it's a mission sometimes to drag people away from the birding when birds like this rainbow bearded thornbill come down to point blank range, just feeding on the sugar water from the feeders. A short distance away, another top birding spot in Colombia, which is a part of our itinerary, is at Rio Blanco, just outside the town of Manizales. And this is the home of Albeiro. There he is with his lovely wife. Albeiro was a water ranger. He used to work as a park ranger in the water purification plant up here. But as I see with so many locals involved in birding tourism in South America, he's kind of switched professions, and having guided groups of birders, he's gradually got involved in the birding himself. And he's spotted by tales elsewhere in South America, not least Angel Paz in Ecuador, who arguably pioneered the feeding of ant-pitters. Albeiro has made this one of Colombia's top birding sites, and with species like buff-breasted mountain tanager and the jay-like white-capped tanager come into your garden, who's to argue with the attractions here? There is the view from Albeiro's garden down into the town of Manizales. And if any of you watching are into your cycling and wonder why there's a profusion of Colombian cyclists on the Tour de France and the other grand tours, well, you only have to drive around the streets in Manizales to see the interest in cycling there is in Colombia. It's quite phenomenal. There isn't a street in Manizales which isn't at a 45 degree angle, at least that's my perception. And the streets are thronged with keen, eager young Colombian cyclists powering up and down these hills. So it's no wonder that the Tour de France is now populated by a number of these talented young cyclists. So this is Albeiro in one of his ant-pitter feeding stations. You must go to Angel Paz in Mindo in Ecuador if ever you're in Ecuador. But this is a top ant-pitter site in Colombia. We get up at dawn, nice breakfast, and we'll go down and accompany Albeiro to, I think he's got about 3 feeding stations now. So we park ourselves on these benches, and you can focus your camera into the dense foliage there at the back of the hide. And Albeiro literally, like Angel Paz in Ecuador, just feeds these fat earthworms to the birds, and they'll come hopping out, chestnut crowned, ant-pitter bottom right. And a real speciality here, bottom left, is the bicolored ant-pitter. But we get normally 3 or 4 species here. At Rio Blanco. and it's a great opportunity to take some photos of birds which 20 years ago, before the advent of these feeding stations, were incredibly difficult to see. Up to the north of Colombia now, on a completely different change of scenery. This is the very dry and arid Guajira Peninsula, with Venezuela just over the border to the west here. We'll fly up to either Santa Marta or Riohacha, spend a few days exploring this dry peninsula, and then finish our Santa Marta tour up in the hills and the mountains of the Santa Marta range itself. So we leave behind the temperate and subtropical forests of the Andes and find ourselves in a very hot and humid, at times mosquito-infested coastal environment here, with the Wayuu Indians, who and the native people, they still to this day live primarily from fishing and subsistence agriculture, but they're very welcoming. And as I've touched on elsewhere, one or two of the bird guides we use come from the local community, and it's great to support them in that way. And we're looking for some special species here, either Colombian endemics or species shared just with neighbouring Venezuela, like Orinoco saltator, russet-throated puffbird, and the vermilion cardinal. Spine tails are a funny family. They're incredibly difficult through much of their range in South America. They're kind of the ultimate skulker. They really do not like to be seen. They will skulk in dense vegetation. And a lot of them have got very similar plumages. So unless you're in tune with their vocalizations, they're very difficult to identify. But one of the most striking spine tails anywhere is the white whiskered, which is endemic to this very arid region in the north of Colombia. The brackish lagoons are thronged with water birds, ibis, herons, egrets, gulls, cormorants, etc. This is easy birding, of course, just scanning with our telescopes and binoculars. Makes a nice change from the forest birding we've been doing up until now. Great range of water birds here. And now we're heading up towards Minca and the Santa Marta Range. There's some lovely, well-appointed birders' lodges here, with owners who are more than happy to get up at the crack of dawn and ply us with freshly squeezed orange juice and delicious breakfasts, while we enjoy the hummingbirds and the other birds coming to the feeders. And then we head up away from the Caribbean coast and up into the Santa Marta Range, birding as we go. This is El Dorado Lodge, a place I'd always wanted to visit. It's one of the meccas again of neotropical birding. And I have to say, my visit in 2015 didn't disappoint. It's a brilliant place, lovely views all around, great hospitality, bird-rich grounds and gardens. And I think there's about 29 Santa Marta endemics, and in a stay of 3 or 4 days here, you have a great shot at seeing all of those endemics, with just one or two proving to be more tricky. One of the star birds of the lodge's gardens is this stunning hummingbird, the black-backed thornbill. One of the early mornings, we'll drive an hour out of the lodge uphill, and from there we're afforded a view of the high peaks of the Santa Marta Range. Bottom left, you can see a close-up of the three highest peaks, Pico Cristobal Colón and Pico Simón Bolívar, are the two highest peaks, just under 19,000 feet. Those mountains in the distance there are part of an Indian refuge, so you can't go over there and you can't climb the summits. Not that we'd be interested in kind of extreme mountaineering. It's interesting the perspective here, because when I went to El Dorado, I had this perception of the lodge being actually on this isolated set of peaks itself. I had no idea of the sheer scale of these mountains, and it is breathtaking when you have that view and you've got endemic birds pecking around your feet for crumbs, with the prospect of flocks of tanagers as we work our way down in the morning. It rivaled the morning at Montezuma for one of my best birding days ever. So a close up of the three highest peaks there, 20 miles off in the clear morning air. Just a couple of the endemic birds that we look for here, the Santa Marta brush finch, and my favourite, the Santa Marta mountain tanager. I think around about 20, perhaps more, of the Santa Marta endemic birds are prefixed simply with Santa Marta. So you get Santa Marta wren, Santa Marta tanager, Santa Marta warbler, Santa Marta screech owl, etc. So it's nice to keep in tune and have some familiar bird names once you get going. So a brilliant place and highly recommended on our Santa Marta endemics tour. So that's a whistle-stop tour of Colombia. We're 5 or 10 minutes over, thereabouts, but still time for a few questions before 9:30. I would just like to say, on behalf of myself, the general manager of Naturetrek, and all of our wonderful staff, tough weeks ahead, I think. I know a lot of you are viewing from the UK, but there's also a number of you viewing from around the world. We're heading for a tough few weeks here in England with a 6-week minimum lockdown. So I wish you strength and fortitude for the weeks ahead, whether you live alone or whether you're caring for elderly relatives. Whatever your concerns, we wish you well from all the team. I hope you join us for more of our talks in the upcoming days. We've got about 10 or 12, I think, lined up. It's been a pleasure to bring this to you this evening. I hope you've enjoyed it. I'll just hand over to Sarah to kind of sign off and get our questions and answers underway.
Great. Thanks very much, Andy. And fantastic talk. Definitely really enjoyed that. So some questions just to finish off then. There's one from Dave Caulfield for Andy. He says you did a similar tour to your Peru one that you've just gone through. Back in 1986, stay in Paracas, explorers in Cusco and Machu Picchu, amongst others. How much has it changed since then, since 1986, and is it worth a repeat trip now?
Yeah, I saw that question. Thanks, Dave, earlier on. I had another couple of questions on the Inca Trail, which I'll deal with at the same time, if that's okay. I think, Dave, you'll certainly find that Peru's changed since 1986. It's become more commercial, it's modernised, but the charm is still very much there. And from someone who spent 2 years in the Amazon rainforest, I got up each morning and saw a different thing every day. So I think to go to Peru and think you've seen it and done it in a two-week holiday would never happen. It's always worth a repeat visit. You'll see things that you didn't see on your first visit. You'll appreciate the changes. And you could spend 6 months in Peru and not see everything. So I very much recommend a repeat visit. You will see changes, not all for the best, but certainly not all for the worst either. If I can just quickly tackle another couple of questions I had on the Inca Trail. I've had a couple of questions on the fitness required and how busy is the Inca Trail? How do we manage the bird when it's so famously busy? On the fitness side of things, 28 miles in 5 days should be within scope of people. I say if you're in the UK, apologies if you're outside of UK with the Bracken Beacons, Lake District, Peak District, but if you are capable of a decent day out on those hills covering 5 or 10 miles, then you'd cope with the trail without a problem. The Inca Trail is busy, but the Peruvian authorities started to limit access a few years ago to 500 trekking permits per day, so it's a much more pleasant experience now than it was 15 or 20 years ago when it was a free-for-all, ad hoc toilets all over the place. Everything now is much more regimented and you have to abide by the book, and that's to the great benefit of the trail and the wider environment. Just on the busyness of the trail and birding, what we tend to do is we set off first thing in the morning in front of all of the other groups, and then what happens in the morning is all the other young backpackers overtake us at great speed, and then for the majority of the rest of the day we've got the trail to ourselves to birdwatch at our leisure. So while most groups arrive at the next night's campsite at lunchtime, 1 o'clock, we'll typically take our time and not arrive until maybe 3 o'clock. And therefore, we do have big chunks of peace and quiet on the trail. Did that answer the question, Dave?
Yeah, I think so. There was one other point just on the Inca Trail, Andy, from Natalie, who said, how do people who don't want to walk the Inca Trail spend those few days on the trip?
Yeah, people that don't want to trek but still want to see Machu Picchu, we funnel you off to go to Cock of the Rock Lodge on the Manu Road. So similar to some of the lodges that myself and Byron have been talking about. Go down there for 3 nights, have some nice birding excursions, lovely pristine cloud forest environment. Then you get driven back to Cusco, spend another night, and then take the train to Machu Picchu, where you'll rendezvous with the trekkers. So it all works seamlessly, and we can split the group easily in that fashion. For a friend of you planning a trip to Machu Picchu, whether with us or not, my key tip, I think, is to spend the night at the ruins or Aguas Calientes. A day trip is possible from Cusco, but it's rushed and it's crowded, and there's nothing quite as magical as going up to Machu Picchu and seeing the sunrise, or indeed seeing the sunset. And you can only do that if you spend the night in the vicinity.
And a question from Rachel Booth. What are the average group sizes, and is it easy to travel just as a couple with a private tour or a private guide, so they can stay as long as they want with particular wildlife rather than being with a group? So really a tailor-made question there, Andy, but it doesn't say what country it's in reference to, but for all destinations we've covered tonight, I think tailor-made is possible.
Yeah, absolutely. Across the board, our group sizes vary from 5 to 16, but on birding tours where the terrain and the forest is enclosed, we've got to be very careful with group sizes. Any more than about 7 or 8, it becomes unwieldy. So for some of our birding tours, you'll find group sizes capped at around about 8, whereas for tours in Europe and more open tours, we'll take up to 16, unless we're taking full charter of a boat, in which case we can have up to 80 or 90. But generally speaking, it's between 5 and 16, and it depends on the tour. And as to the tailor-made aspect of that question, we do have a dedicated tailor-made department. So if you want your own bespoke itinerary designed and operated to your own specific requirements, be it 2 weeks in a particular lodge or a particular photographic subject or target, then we can help with that as well. And you're the kind of, you know, we work closely with you to design an itinerary which exactly fits.
Great, thanks, Andy. Another question here from Tracy Williams. How do folk get on with taking large camera lenses to these places? Tracy's book to go on the Inca Trail. Regarding flight, luggage size and storage in the accommodation and safety with storing camera equipment.
Well, but yeah, Byron and Tom would back me up on this one. The digital photographic revolution has meant that, you know, a large number of our clients will take serious camera equipment away with them these days, that in some cases it's almost replaced binoculars and telescopes. So we're aware that these are expensive, cherished pieces of equipment. So not only are there opportunities to indulge in photography on a lot of these holidays, but also there'll be the backup staff and the safety deposit boxes and the vehicle security needed to help safeguard those pieces of equipment. A stickler can be luggage allowance on internal flights, and this does vary from tour to tour and country to country, but we'll advise you on that. And if extra cabin luggage is necessary, often we can pay the airline to secure that. So there are ways around these problems.
Great, thanks, Andy. Just two more questions. One from Alan Woodward. Would now be the best time to book, or should we wait? General question there, $1 million question. And it doesn't say which destination it's in reference to, but Andy, if you want to take that one again.
Yeah, thanks, Alan. Good memories of our time at Rennie Panny together. I hope you're keeping well. Well, you know, as a tour operator battling their way through this pandemic, clearly we're extremely grateful for any bookings that are coming our way at the moment. But the fact is that we're well aware that times are extremely uncertain, and that a lot of you will be waiting for things to become clearer before committing holiday cash. So we can hold provisional places. We're accepting bookings. We're trying to be as flexible and as reassuring as possible with our booking conditions, you know, a pledge for a full refund or transfer should it transpire that we find ourselves in lockdown or the Foreign Office would advise against travel. We're trying to be as helpful as we possibly can. So it all depends, really. Lots of people are booking holidays for 2022. Let's all hope we're back to normal by then, certainly. And we've seen a good volume of bookings for this summer and autumn as well. So we're here to help, we're here to advise, and we're here to have a chat with you depending on what holidays you're interested in.
And just one last question from Ali Glacier, similarly related to the pandemic. She says many of these lodges and other tourist facilities must be having a very hard time at the moment. Is Naturetrek able to support them at all?
Well, we're looking at this. Clearly, it's a very difficult time for everybody in tourism. We're not alone in Naturetrek in having to have made redundancies. We haven't made any profit since March. So out of necessity, our focus at the moment needs to be on ourselves and our own staff and clients. We want to be in business after the end of the pandemic, and not just be in business, but to to be present in a strong and robust way. And I think the best way we can support our partners and guides around the world is to be in that position at the end of the pandemic and to send your clients over there so they can drive you around and cook for you and guide you. So that's our focus at the moment. But there are individual circumstances, of course, that we're aware of. And we're looking at each of those individually.
Great. Thanks, Andy. And Byron, Tom, or Andy, I don't know if you have anything else to add.
No, it's been a fantastic evening. And I think Andy has pretty much covered all the answers for our questions.
Yeah, great. No, really enjoyed it. And yeah, thanks everyone that's tuned in and joined us. And
yeah.
I want to get out there now.
Well, thank you all three of you for doing your talks this evening. It's been fantastic to listen to. And thank you all so much for joining. This is the first of 13 evenings we have, so please do sign up for others. And we'd also very much appreciate any feedback that you have. This is the first time we've done this, so please do email us at info@naturetrek.co.uk to let us know your thoughts. I see lots of you have been flooding the comments there by saying how much you've enjoyed this evening. So that's really heartwarming to see. And thank you so much for the positive feedback. We'll be back the same time tomorrow evening at 7:30, where we'll be discussing our cruises, taking you from the Arctic to the Antarctic and some fantastic destinations in between. We hope you can join us then. Until then, take care and good night, everybody. Thank you for joining us.